Hey everybody, Reid here. Welcome to a very special Jund video here on ChannelFireball.com. What I'm going to do today is I'm going to run this through the Modern Challenge, which is a very cool Saturday tournament on Magic Online. Seems like we have almost 200 players, which means we're going to be playing 8 rounds, and you're going to get every single match on video here. Now I'm recording and promising to post this on the website before I know the results, so I might go 2-6, or I might have a good run, make it all the way to the top 8. Either way, we're going to be trying our best, trying to have some good games and learn a bit with Jund. Now, regarding my particular deck list that I've chosen for today, on the suggestion of Logan Jabberwocky Nettles, I've been playing 2 Dark Confidants in place of the normal either Tireless Tracker or Seasoned Pyromancer. I found the deck runs a lot smoother in the matchups where you really need an early threat, things like Urzatron, Blue-White Control, Storm Combo. Dark Confidant is very, very good in those matchups, even though it does have some vulnerabilities. Now, we can talk more about the sideboard, and I guess my interesting choice here is I'm playing 3 copies of Nihil Spellbomb, which is not completely necessary after the banning of Hogak Arisen Necropolis, but, you know, I've gone back and forth with a third copy of Plague Engineer, third anti-burn sideboard card. But for this particular event, I think there's enough different matchups where Nihil Spellbomb is useful, and I don't want to be completely cold if someone does bring Dredge or Vengevine or something like that. And I've just decided to make my deck a little more well-rounded by playing the 3 Spellbombs. But that's definitely a judgment call, and you can turn the dials based on what matchups you expect. Well, without further ado, let's get into match number 1. Off to a bad start here, so I'm definitely going to have to mulligan this 0 land hand on the draw. And this is passable, though made awkward by the fact that I do not have 2 black mana for my Liliana, so I think I'm going to bottom one of these Raging Ravines and just hope that I can find an untapped black land by turn 3. If I have to have a Raging Ravine hand, this is the type of hand where I don't mind, because I can just play a 1-mana spell and then a 1-mana spell and a tapped land. Ooh, looks like we might have a mirror match right off the bat here. I don't think my list is particularly well-suited to the mirror match. Dark Confidant is definitely not as strong as Tireless Tracker and Seasoned Pyromancer in this matchup. I don't have any Planeswalkers or Huntmaster of the Fells in my sideboard, so I may be a little bit outgunned, but you know what? We're probably going to have 70 out of 75 cards in common anyway, so it can't be that bad. When in doubt, I like to stock up on extra green mana for the purposes of Scavenging Ooze. And sure enough, we do have a mirror, so I'm going to want my discard spells to take out the Kolaghan's Command and the Liliana of the Veil. I'll take Kolaghan's Command first. This card is just very, very brutal in the Jund mirror. Oh no, my opponent drew another discard spell, so they can either take away my Liliana, or they can take away my Inquisition, which will protect their Liliana. Either way, it's pretty bad for me. I think if I had been in my opponent's spot, I would have taken away the Inquisition, because I don't even have a third mana and no answer to an opposing Liliana. But this is actually not going to work out that bad for me, as we're just both basically cleaned out, and I've drawn Kolaghan's Command, which maybe can make something happen 3 or 4 turns down the road. Well, I guess this is as good a time as any to cast the Thoughtseize. I know I can take Maelstrom Pulse, maybe my opponent drew Bloodbraid Elf. Sure. So I still feel that I'm behind in this game because my opponent has more mana than I do and gets the first top deck. So inevitably they're going to find something, and if they happen to find Bloodbraid Elf or Planeswalker, I'm going to be in big trouble. But I don't hate my position. This matchup's very much about patience and getting maximum value out of your cards rather than worrying about speed. So having a couple of very powerful cards in my hand, I don't mind waiting to try and draw my lands. And I even have Fatal Push to cover something like a Tarmogoyf from my opponent. But as I mentioned, I'm just very, very worried about them finding a Planeswalker off the top. All right. So I'll just go ahead and kill that right away. Sure. I'm not super optimistic that this is going to survive, but I don't think there's any reason not to just play it. And at worst, it turns on my Kolaghan's Command as a full value 2-for-1. Scratch that about the Kolaghan's Command. This could be an interesting battle depending on what my opponent draws this turn. If they just draw a land, a blank, the situation's pretty good for me. But if they draw something to kill the Dark Confidant or apply extra pressure, then it could be pretty rough. Alright, well, I still don't fully have the tools to kill the Scavenging Ooze. What I can do is try to block and then use a burn spell. It's a bit tricky with the Kolaghan's Command because normally a great play would be to block and then end of turn two more damage and return the Dark Confidant. But of course, if the Dark Confidant goes to the graveyard, the Scavenging Ooze can get an extra counter. Also, if I try to make my opponent discard at instant speed, they could discard a creature and then eat it with the ooze. So there's a lot that could go wrong. I'm thinking I may just block and use the Lightning Bolt. And normally, against any creature other than Scavenging Ooze, I would want to wait and resolve combat damage before doing the Lightning Bolt. But I want my Dark Confidant to be in the graveyard for the purposes of Kolaghan's Command, so I'm going to make the somewhat risky play of bolting here. And if my opponent kills the Dark Confidant, then I'll be 2-for-1, but it kind of seems like my opponent doesn't have a removal spell for the Confidant. That's big. That is very big. And my opponent is asking the same question that I just discussed of why bolt pre-damage instead of resolving the damage. And the reason is I don't want the Scavenging Ooze to eat my Dark Confidant. I guess I should pass in case my opponent plays Bloodbraid Elf. I might want the Kolaghan's Command at instant speed. But basically, I'm pretty sure I'm going to have to pick up my Dark Confidant and make my opponent discard. Ghost Quarter, fascinating. And I guess I might as well do it now during combat, just in case my opponent thought they were going to play something post-combat. and it was just a swamp. Still in pretty bad shape. I can at least play a chump blocker for the Tarmogoyf, but you got to figure if my opponent has a good draw step at any point in this game, it's going to become very tough for me to win. Yeah, that is not ideal. Now I just don't get to get any traction, play a creature, chump block. I was hoping for a fourth land to play the Bloodbraid, or of course, you know, a Fatal Push or Abrupt Decay would be amazing, but even just a fourth land would have been better than drawing another Confidant. Yep, that should be game if my opponent just pings the Confidant. Alright, so moving to sideboard, I don't think there's consensus on the best way of sideboarding in the Jund Mirror. My personal preference is to take out as many of the discard spells as I can, and I think Plague Engineer, Fulminator Mage, and Nihil Spellbomb are all sort of marginal cards. They're not the greatest, but they're okay. Collective Brutality I would only have if I saw a bunch of, like, Dark Confidants, Tireless Trackers, creatures that could actually die to the -2/-2 effect. Otherwise, I'd rather have these. Similarly, Plague Engineer, very good if my opponent has Dark Confidant or Seasoned Pyromancer, but kind of just an overpriced 2/2 otherwise. So I think I'm going to go with this configuration with the Spell Bombs and the Fulminators. And since there will inevitably be questions about why I take out the discard spells, the reason is that I think this matchup comes down to top decks in such a large portion of the games, like 80 or 90% of the games, that I just don't want to weaken myself in a top deck battle, weaken my Cascades with Bloodbraid Elf. Now, this hand is very mediocre, below average. But this is also a matchup that's pretty bad to mulligan in because you do so much trading off and the raw number of resources is important. I think I'm going to make the judgment call to mulligan just because this hand is bad enough and we have the London mulligan now to make it a little bit less painful. But there's a real risk of ruin here. Like, if I mulligan and don't have lands and I have to go to five, I'm basically just going to lose before the game even starts. So I'm considering keeping this, even with how bad it is, but I think it's just barely over the line where I'm going to take a mulligan. Okay, and this is actually much better. I do wish I had Ren in 6, but hopefully the Nihil Spellbomb can help me find my mana. And believe it or not, I may actually just bottom the Tarmogoyf. No, I guess I should bottom the Fulminator Mage. And life total does matter in this matchup, so I'm going to make the judgment call to play a tapped land. Nihil Spellbomb, of course, can be more powerful later in the game when my opponent might be thinking about things like Kolaghan's Command. Alright, now it's not ideal to play the Tarmogoyf into a board where it can get lightning bolted, but the fact that I have two Kolaghan's Commands means that I don't even mind if my opponent spends a removal spell, because then I can get my clean 2-for-1 when I want to if I hit my third land, and it looks like my opponent doesn't have lightning bolt anyway, so that's fine. Alright, I kind of hate to do this, but I think I'm just going to... Well, no, I guess I should just attack for one and put the spell on into play. I'm thinking, you know, if I use the spell bomb, my Goyf has an extra power. And maybe I can hit a land drop, but I think it's better to try to at least counter one activation of the Ren and Six with the spell bomb. So I am fortunate enough to hit my land drop, but still pretty ugly situation for me. Facing down two planeswalkers. Now, because my opponent's ahead on resources and has this particularly devastating combination, I'm going to make the judgment call to just destroy the Liliana with Kolaghan's Command right now. So I don't have to lose any of the cards in my hand. And sure, Overgrown Tomb untapped seems fine. So I return Tarmogoyf and I deal 2 damage to Liliana. And then hopefully Bloodbraid Elf can get me out of this sticky situation. Well, Bloodbraid's rather unexciting in the face of a Tarmogoyf, so maybe I will just play my own Tarmogoyf and then have access to Lightning Bolt and Fatal Push. Ouch. Now, the question is if I want to disguise that I have Lightning Bolt by using my Blood Crypt, or whether I want to just fetch a swamp and then it'll be pretty obvious what I have, but I'll save 2 points of life. Another reasonably tough judgment call. But I do like to value my life total in a game like this. Sure. So I can either discard Lightning Bolt, or I can discard Kolaghan's Command, bolt the Ren and Six, and then Bloodbraid and hope something good happens. Kolaghan's Command is super, super powerful, so I really don't want to discard it, but the thing is, I might just have to discard it next turn anyway if the Liliana keeps working on me. Although maybe not, because my opponent could Edict with the Liliana. Still, I think I'm just going to play to get one of the Planeswalkers off the battlefield, so discard Kolaghan's Command, Lightning Bolt. Maybe I can be fortunate enough to cascade into, like, Abrupt Decay or something like that. So my opponent has 5 cards. I know 2 of them are Bloodstained Mire and Nurturing Peatland. We really need a good cascade here, not a fatal push, please. That's excellent, actually. I still feel a bit behind in this game based on my opponent's general accumulation of resources with the Renin 6. But that turn went, you know, about as well as I could have hoped for. Okay. Looks like my opponent has chosen to have Collective Brutality in that marginal slot. That could have been, you know, Nihil Spellbomb or Inquisition of Kozilek. Which makes sense because I do have Dark Confidant, while my opponent maybe doesn't. And not using Liliana, which is pretty interesting. I'm empty-handed, but I do know my opponent has that Bloodstained Mire, which didn't seem to have tremendous value, so tough judgment call. Anyway, I'll focus on my own game. I think it seems good to use the Spell Bomb right away, just to maybe draw into something. And normally here I would play the Black Cleave Cliffs, but I guess it could give my opponent a little bit of pause, having an unknown card in my hand when they have a Liliana that they might be deciding whether to plus or minus or whatever. Okay. Maybe I made a bad judgment call about the Spell Bomb. Maybe I should have really prioritized waiting to break up the Nurturing Peatland Renin 6 combo. Of course, I didn't know my opponent had another Renin 6, but it does make sense. I was just, you know, really looking forward to the potential of drawing something that turn that could help me battle the Liliana, but I just drew a land, so it worked out pretty badly. And now we get to the stage where the only way I get back in this game is drawing Bloodbraid Elf or Kolaghan's Command. Somehow that's not as bad as it could have been. Alright, I think I need Kolaghan's Command. Or Bloodbraid into Kolaghan's Command. Nope, so I can just play the Goyf. I'll get edicted by Liliana and attacked for another 5, so I'm going to have to concede this one. That was a sound beating, but if I have to lose to something, might as well be Jund. And I will definitely be back for round number 2. See you then. Alright, I'm back for match number 2 of today's Modern Challenge. I'm on the draw, but I like this opening hand. Turn 1, Bolt. Turn 2, Renin 6, which can fix my mana for double black. Somewhat interesting which land to play on turn 1, because if I play Wooded Foothills and I have to fetch red for Lightning Bolt, then I will not be able to curve Renin 6 into Liliana, right? Because either I get a black-red and I can't cast Renin 6, or I get a black or a green-red and can't cast Liliana on turn 3. So depending on what my opponent's first land drop is, if they're playing a creature deck, I probably just have to leave with Basic Mountain. My opponent, by the way, is mulliging down to 5 cards. Okay, I'm going to guess Grixis Death Shadow based on the Scalding Tarn Street Wraith opening. Alright, so I've drawn another land, which makes my Lightning Bolt Dilemma a little bit more manageable, so I'll just play the Wooded Foothills. Plus Grixis Death Shadow, sometimes there's like a Jace Vryn's Prodigy or two, but they're pretty unlikely to just main phase a creature on turn 2 that I can Lightning Bolt. We may have an incoming Delve creature on turn 2, which is probably the best way for Grixis to beat Jund. So if we see Take Liliana, play a land, play a Gurmag Angler, game's going to get very difficult for me to win, because then I can't even really play Renin 6 on turn 2. None of my cards are very effective. Alright. Dodge the Delve creature. So this definitely makes me think of Kolaghan's Command, maybe to pick up Death Shadow or Street Wraith. So I think I'm supposed to just play Liliana, because if she gets Stumbler Denial, then at least it means my opponent's mana is probably going to waste. And if they're holding Stumbler Denial, then they'll just wait. They'll be able to just counter Liliana at a later point anyway with the Ferocious ability. And if it's just Kolaghan's command, I do get to take the Liliana up to 4. So even 2 damage will have her able to edict away my opponent's first creature. And I just don't really have anything great to spend my mana on otherwise. So I am going to make this judgment call. Sure. So here's a Delve creature. So this matchup's kind of interesting because it's generally a bad idea to just aggressively attack their life total for the obvious reason of Death Shadow. But you often get the dust settling on a situation like this where, yes, the Gurmag Angler is going to be the biggest creature on the battlefield, but my opponent can't really afford to trade hits with my smaller creatures because their life total is so low. So it winds up being kind of interesting. All right, so only thing I can really do is 2 damage to player and make them discard. And then I'll have a 3-2 and I'll be passing the turn. I guess if I wanted, I could target the angler with the damage and then attack with Bloodbraid, which might result in more damage. So that would have been a good consideration. Well, here goes nothing. Now, I guess I'll shock myself with the Blood Crypt, just in case my opponent plays a creature that can be Abrupt Decayed. I may want access to all 3 of these spells in the next 2 turns, which would make me want to have the untapped Blood Crypt. Well, my opponent gets a draw off the bauble. They did target themselves. And I don't know yet whether they're gonna fetch or draw the card they saw on top. I guess I can go for a win here, or at least threaten it. So they did go ahead and draw that card, which means they believe that they can win with that card. So it probably has to be an instant, like a Snapcaster, a Kolaghan's Command, or a Fatal Push. Or a Stubborn Denial is possible as well. So maybe I'll just play Dark Confidant and pass. Alright, how about we return Dark Confidant, deal 2 damage to player. Sure. So what I'm going to do here is, I guess it doesn't even matter, just Edict, then Abrupt Decay the Snapcaster, and go for the win. And my opponent will need to have exactly Fatal Push in order to survive. Alright, well that was sort of the easy one, since my opponent did mulligan to 5. I would say these 5 cards are pretty strong additions. Now, unlike the Jund Mirror where I just played, I actually do like keeping in the discard in this matchup because you have to A, fight through Stubborn Denial, and B, break up the Snapcaster Kolaghan's Command engine. But the card that is a little bit worse is Lightning Bolt, since it can't kill Death Shadow. And then I don't really want to cut any of this top end stuff, so we could be looking at cutting a Confidant, Ooze, or Goyf, or trimming a discard spell, or maybe not bringing in the third Nile Spell Bomb. I do like Plague Engineer because it can trade against the bigger creatures and pick off a Snapcaster here and there, so it seems at least okay. Maybe I will just cut Dark Confidant. Even Lightning Bolt is not terrible in the matchup, but I do think it's one of the weaker cards. I don't love that my hand has no black mana, but I do have 2 lands and 3 castable cards, and it's a matchup where it's pretty painful to mulligan, so I think it's a keep. Well, I put my opponent on a Stubborn Denial here. But what should I do with that information? Maybe I just lead on Tarmogoyf? It's not that bad to just play the Ren and 6 into Stubborn Denial, because as I said in game 1, the Stubborn Denial is a card that they can usually find a use for anyway. It's not like you can make it dead for the whole game, except in some unique cases. Jace. Well, now I'm wishing I left in Lightning Bolt, because that card can be pretty devastating. Now I can't really play Scavenging Ooze because my opponent can just Fatal Push it. So I'm now left with the choice of either playing the Renin 6 into a possible Stubborn Denial, or playing Nihil Spellbomb with no black mana. Neither of those is super appealing, but I guess the Renin 6 at least does something, can tick up in loyalty. And who knows, maybe I was wrong about the Stubborn Denial and should have just played Renin 6 on turn 2. So my opponent delved away everything, including the Fatal Push. So what do I make of that? Are they valuing their 3 mana? Maybe you have Kolaghan's Command or Snapcaster. I like that draw, because now I can really get the black mana flowing with my Renin 6. Feels like I should start with Inquisition. Like maybe Inquisition into Scavenging Ooze. Because if I just play Plague Engineer, it's... First of all, the Jace can manage it. Second of all, it's very unlikely to survive. Sure. So... I guess I want to take the push and try to stick Scavenging Ooze. So let's see, if I take the push, then my opponent can't really Kolaghan's Command the Ooze because I can just eat the Goyf. And if they start their turn by -3 on the Fatal Push, then I have to eat the Fatal Push. Then they can Kolaghan's Command, but at least it takes a lot of mana and the loyalty off their Planeswalker. I don't think there's any way I can keep my Renin 6 alive through this turn. Alternatively, I could... Yeah, I mean, I think that's just what I'm going to do. Take the Fatal Push, play the Ooze. So both the Teemer Battle Rage and the Jace are good at making the Gurmag Angler beat the Plague Engineer in combat. So I don't think I... Yeah, I don't know. I'm not going to block. Whoa, attacking me. Alright. Sure, so just using this as Lava Axe. I wonder if maybe they drew a second Battle Rage. Okay. So it is just a Kolaghan's in hand, command in hand for my opponent. What would I like to do with that information? Ooh, I don't have a second swamp, which makes this annoying. I guess I'll just attack Jace for one. I need a little bit of help off the top of my library if I'm going to win this game. The good news is I can at least make the minus three ability of Jace ineffective between the ooze and the spell bomb. So if I draw Maelstrom Pulsar Liliana, I'm golden. I can kill the Gurmag Angler and be in good shape. If I draw a discard spell, I can take away the Kolaghan's command and then stick the Plague Engineer, but there's still the Jace to plus and neutralize the Plague Engineer's death touch. If I draw Tarmogoyf, it might be big enough to make a difference. I'm also only one loyalty away from Renin 6 emblem. Well, that's no help. So I can try to block with a Raging Ravine. I could just play Plague Engineer. That actually seems like a fine decision. Just play, like, I don't know. Wooded Foothills Plague Engineer. I guess if I was going to fetch right away, I should have played the land that I'd already shown, Bloodstained Mire, so I gave away some free information. Opponent deciding where they want to point the damage with the Kolaghan's command. Might as well take my one life. Okay. Now I can make the Wren emblem, but I do need something to pair with it. Well, I guess the move is I can play Dark Confidant and have two blockers available between the Ravine and the Confidant. Yep. Sometimes people overthink it like this. I think my opponent should just attack and force the chump block, but they're going to try to get greedy and kill me with my own confidant. See if it works for them. Okay, so let's begin with emblem. Then Inquisition from the graveyard to clear the way. Now, tempting to Inquisition again, in case their other card is exactly another Stubborn Denial, but Snapcaster kind of gets me either way. So I think I'm just going to play Lily. Also, I can't afford to lose any life from this position. All right. So now my opponent can emblem the Jace, but I don't think that's a very good way, an effective way to win the game, especially when I have Wren emblem. Alright. So, I guess I'm fine just drawing a card end of turn. Because I'm not going to tap this for mana. Oh, wow, and I would have revealed this to Dark Confidant. So, of course I'm not changing my odds of dying, but that was a fateful choice. It's kind of fun to think about. It was not a fateful choice because I just had two Blood Braids in a row. All right, well, I felt like I had that one locked up, though I do have to admit I got lucky on the first Dark Confidant flip, unlucky on the second one, so. Oh well, that happens. Yeah, greatness at any cost, that's right. Let me bring in a couple Lightning Bolts to hedge against the Vryn's Prodigy, and then maybe the Plague Engineer, or maybe Confidant and Plague Engineer come out. One Lightning Bolt may be enough when I'm on the draw, because Kolaghan's Command and Liliana basically come in fast enough to answer the Vryn's Prodigy. So I don't know whether I want one or two Lightning Bolts. I could see bringing in a Confidant or a Plague Engineer in its spot. I think I'll run with this, though. Like I said, Lightning Bolt's not bad in the matchup, life total matters a lot, and you sort of make your opponent walk that fine line. Kill Snapcaster Mage too. Very good hand. All right. Generally, I like to just take the most powerful card, which in this case is going to be Kolaghan's Command. The rough plan is that my two Inquisitions will take away Kolaghan's Command and Death Shadow, so hypothetically I could do that in any order I want, but the Inquisition, like, something can go wrong, right? My opponent could draw another card that I need the Inquisition, they could make me discard this, they could counter it. Abrupt Decay is nice for breaking up the Death Shadow Stubborn Denial combination. It is uncounterable, remember? Well, I feel like I should play Inquisition this turn because I can get it in through the Stubborn Denial. And we have Lightning Bolt, Stubborn Denial. Those don't do much. Thought Scour, you know, cycles, fills the graveyard. And then Death Shadow and Plague Engineer are both powerful but can be answered by Abrupt Decay. I guess I should take Death Shadow because it is the cheapest card, and if taking this allows me to attack with the Tarmogoyf. Sure. So I could Bloodbraid. I could go Abrupt Decay Ooze. The Ooze is just going to die to Lightning Bolt. I think I like taking my chance with Bloodbraid because I have a lot of really good cascades, and even if I don't hit something to answer the Plague Engineer, I can pretty comfortably attack with just Bloodbraid and leave back the Goyf. Could also play Scavenging Ooze and eat the two creatures, but I should have that option at a later time. Yep, so this is going to put my opponent down to 2 life, make it really difficult for them to ever fetch or Thought Seize or Dismember. I have tons of live draws to win right away, so my position's great. All right, there's Bloodbraid for you. Bloodbraid, I guess, killed me in game 2, but won the game for me in game 3. That's how it goes. I'll see you for the next round. Welcome back for match number 3. Currently 1-1 in the Modern Challenge, and don't think I can keep a 5 lander like this against an unknown opponent, especially many decks, Fatal Pushes, and ineffective cards, so I'm going to need to do better than this. Basically the same hand. I suppose I will keep it and bottom maybe Verdant Catacombs. At least this hand will be pretty good against the creature deck. I suppose I should bottom the Overgrown Tomb in case I draw Ren and Six right away. Also, maybe my opponent plays like a Snow-Covered Mountain and I live in fear of Blood Moon. Wow, that is an interesting prediction. Bomat Courier. Alright. So what am I making of this? Do I want to be prepared for Blood Moon? Do I want to maybe just not fetch and then untap and Lightning Bolt the Bomat? I really have no idea what's going on. If my opponent is playing a Blood Moon deck, then getting basic forest is a priority, so I don't really want to get Swamp and Fatal Push. I think I'll just take the one, then I'll play Blackleaf Cliffs, and I'll reevaluate for next turn. Kolaghan's Command is also quite effective against Bomat Courier. Yeah, I'm not familiar with this deck, or if it even is an established deck as compared to just my opponent's brew. Hall of Triumph is going to give red creatures +1/+1. Weird stuff going on here. I still want to play around Blood Moon to whatever extent I can, and Ren and Six can help me do that. So why don't I go Crack for Forest, Ren and Six, pick it up, and then do I Lightning Bolt that right away? My inclination is yes, just because I don't know what bad things can happen to me. I guess I can always respond to my opponent casting an artifact by bolting. I wonder if this is maybe some kind of Koldotha red deck. I'm really in the dark here. I'm just trying to make the best decisions that I can with my uncertainty. I will now bolt the Goblin Engineer because I might have to do it sooner or later, and I don't want my Planeswalker to be in Lightning Bolt range. Sure. So I think I'm starting on Bloodbraid and then probably just dealing a damage to a Goblin token. I am going to guess that this is a Koldotha red deck, which means my opponent probably has a number of ways to pump up all their creatures, like Bushwhackers or whatever else, which is why I'm really prioritizing killing these goblins. Okay, so my first thought was that I was going to go Renin 6, pick up a land, Kolaghan's Command, the Engineer, and make my opponent discard. Now I could make an alternative choice of playing Liliana. That seems bad. I think Liliana's out. I still think I'm going to stick with that plan. I'm a little bit afraid of the Engineer, so I want to make sure that card is out of the picture. And who knows if Inquisition is going to be that much more impactful than just making my opponent choose and discard anyway. Phyrexian Soul Gorger. Wow, that's a sweet card. 3 mana, 8/8. Very good if you can give it haste. Or bring it into play at the end of the turn with Goblin Engineer. Devastating Summons. Reckless Bushwhacker. Coming in hot. Okay, so now it's going to be shoot a token. I guess I can Inquisition and then maybe Edict with the Liliana rather than plussing. I do have to take one additional damage to do that, but I think it's worthwhile. I just want to. Maybe this was not a good play. Maybe. Maybe, no, I don't think there's any way I could keep myself out of Lightning Bolt range anyway, because either I leave one more token on the battlefield, or I take one damage from my lands. So I should be dead to Lightning Bolt or Goblin Bushwhacker, but not Reckless Bushwhacker. Okay. Now my opponent has a tough choice of whether to kill the Liliana or just put me down to three. Feels like that's probably their best chance, is put me to three and then have a number of draw steps for Lightning Bolt. But they're gonna make the judgment call to kill the Liliana, which is fine. I would love to find Scavenging Ooze, something along those lines. Man, two bricks. Yep, I think I'm still just shooting a token. Dead to the same cards, Goblin Bushwhacker or Lightning Bolt. Brutal. I actually think it's probably right for me to return the peat land this turn rather than pinging the servo. I wonder if my opponent has drawn Reckless Bushwhacker. I mean, it could be any 3-mana card or even a land. Little help here. Man, brutal. The key moment. Just had all lands on top of my library. Okay, that's good. So I should, I think, start with this before... Like, the only way it's bad is if I cascade into another Renin 6. But I could also cascade into Fatal Push or Abrupt Decay. So I think I start here. That is exactly what we needed. So I think my opponent's going to have this one shot to find Lightning Bolt. So I guess I'll pass and then upkeep, eat a creature. This is tense, my friends. Opponent has a lot of shots at Lightning Bolt. They have haste creatures. Drew another land. Tarmogoyf increases my clock, so I'm going to... take another crack at Nurturing Peatland. No help there. Oh, maybe I should ping first, because then I have lethal if I hit another Ren. I don't think that does anything. Just not casting it. Don't think putting my opponent to one really does anything, so I guess I can return the peat land and see if I draw exactly Lightning Bolt. All right, so now two decisions here. Number one, do I fetch a mountain and play the Tarmogoyf? Number two, how many creatures do I want to leave in case of some kind of haste shenanigans? Like, it seems the worst that could happen is my opponent has Reckless Bushwhacker and draws Koldotha Rebirth, which would allow them 5 2-power attackers, which in order to survive I would need to not fetch and have 4 blockers. That's impossible. So instead they could have Devastating Summons plus Reckless Bushwhacker, which would be 3 attackers. So I could swing with just Tarmogoyf, play Tarmogoyf, and have three blockers and be representing lethal pretty comfortably for next turn. I don't think the two life total is very relevant in terms of burn spells. Like, my opponent's not going to have shock or anything. And do I have to worry about them just playing some number of blockers? They would really need three blockers in order to survive my next attack. So I think that's what I'm going to do. I'm going to attack for six, fetch mountain, play another Goyf. And I really hope my opponent doesn't have burst lightning or something. All right, do your worst, red player. This is it. Oh no, they get one more shot at lightning bolt like this. All right. Ooh, man, dodged a lot of bullets that game. That was, from how good my start was, that was a bit close for comfort. Now, despite this being an artifact deck, Collector Oof does not seem particularly effective. Ancient Grudge is probably fine. Plague Engineer is amazing. Collective Brutality, amazing. Probably Thoughtseize coming out. Dark Confidant coming out. Liliana coming out. These last two Lilianas, do I have anything better? Like, would I prefer to have just 2-mana 2/2 Collector Oof? Maybe. I mean, it at least stops Bomat Courier ability, so it's slightly better than Grizzly Bear. Grizzly Bear honestly just seems fine in this matchup. How about we'll compromise one Lily, one Collector Oof? I like this hand because I can play around Blood Moon also. Alright, so we have Second Land, Goblin Engineer, Ichor Wellspring, Cold Oath of Rebirth, Reckless Bushwhacker. So I feel like I want to disrupt the Ichor Wellspring, Cold Oath of Rebirth combination. I don't have an answer to the Goblin Engineer, so that's really good with the Wellspring also. So I think I should just take the Wellspring. It's even good with Phyrexia's Core. Okay, so Mountain was the draw this turn. Let's see what Goblin Engineer finds. Massive Tarmogoyf. It's good. Alright, so my opponent really refilled their hand that turn. That was a good turn. Inquisition seems important here. And I guess I take away the Bushwhacker because I can... Well, I can destroy the Hall of Triumph, but there's the Goblin Engineer to worry about. So maybe I should just take the Hall of Triumph. All right, this is a big turn here. I think there are a lot of draws that my opponent could have that would be pretty devastating, but if they just draw a land, then I feel really good about my position. And it was just... Oh, no, no, Snow-Covered Mountain is already in hand. It's Bomat Courier. So here's a Bushwhacker and the Goblin Engineer threatening to return Hall of Triumph, Ichor Wellspring, or Phyrexian Soul Gorger. Or actually return the Soul Gorger and then play the Bushwhacker. That's powerful. Starting to see what this deck's all about. I don't think I can very well just take 15 damage, so Scavenging Ooze under the bus. I need to grudge this right away before the Cumulative Upkeep because of the power of Goblin Engineer. All right, another turn where I'm really hoping to fade an artifact. Slightly aggressive attack there, but I'm kind of just hoping my opponent doesn't find something. My gambit paid off. Fatal Push for the Engineer or Blood Braid? Think I can gamble on the Blood Braid. Although maybe not. Maybe my position is good enough that I just want to push the Engineer. It also allows me to hold up Ancient Grudge for what that's worth. Sure. I wonder if it even matters to attack with the Blood Braid. Like, there might be some weird combinations of two cards where I can survive by holding this back and just forcing my opponent to double chump. I think they'd never come back unless they win this turn. So my opponent can always draw Ichor Wellspring into Cold Oath of Rebirth into another draw step. I guess that's always like a backdoor out for this deck. devastating summons, make some zombies. This is really interesting if my opponent does have devastating summons, because they want to make their elementals bigger than the Tarmogoyfs, but if we just have a stalemate where they have no lands, like, they're probably losing that game anyway. So there's a lot to think about. I think my opponent made a good decision to leave themselves with one snow-covered mountain. And now I am going to be using my Nurturing Peatland. See what I can find. All right, the game continues. I should probably just grudge this Astrolabe, because they could draw Cold Oath or Rebirth. And I have... like, I'm never going to use three more activations of Ancient Grudge. Interesting. So if I grudge the Bowmat and I attack with Tarmogoyf, it's a forced block with zombie token. Then my opponent can attack me back and I chump, but then I have lethal. Alternatively, if I do nothing, they can attack me with all four. I go block, chump, basically the same outcome. I think it's probably better for me to force the action, because I can draw removal to win and my opponent can't really. Although, maybe I made an error, because this has me actually losing to the board. Because if my opponent attacks with just elemental, I chump. Then if I draw a land, I'm pretty stuck. Whereas my opponent couldn't really attack me. I guess if they attack with just elemental, I double block. Then it's Blood Radiance, two zombies, and I'm losing that. I'm losing to the board anyway. Huh. I think I block this. Hmm. No, I'll just take it. That's fine. All right. That makes it easy. Well, that was nerve-wracking. Had to dodge a lot of bullets, but I do escape with a win. 2-1. Hi, welcome back for match number 4. After a rough start, I've righted the ship. Now 2-1 in the modern challenge. This hand is acceptable on the play. You always like to have some kind of disruption in the form of removal or discard, but at least I can just play a bunch of big creatures. Ooh. Well, this is the type of hand that I'd have virtually no chance of winning if I had been on the draw, on the play. Who knows what can happen? All right, let's see. I actually think, contrary to the normal pattern, I should lead with Scavenging Ooze and then play Tarmogoyf later when it can be bigger. Like, my opponent's going to have to burn the Ooze, and then I can play the Goyf hopefully as something like a 3-4. I don't think this is going to be a Scavenging Ooze game because I'm going to need to just tap out for Bloodbraid Elf on turns 4 and 5. Now, I think I'm just going to call this bluff because what's likely to happen is my opponent will bolt me, which results in maybe one more damage than if I hadn't blocked, and my opponent would bolt the Ooze and deal 2 to me. But it also restricts them from being able to play something like Eidolon of the Great Revel, and it guarantees that I can play the Tarmogoyf as a larger size next turn. So it is a judgment call, and this is definitely a good attack for my opponent to make, but I'm gonna sort of call the bluff and make them have it. Oh my god. That is almost unbelievable. Well, it looks like I'm not up against Burn at all, but rather a mono red prowess deck. Crash through, light up the stage. Well, I certainly think I should take a spell rather than the Swift Spear. I guess I should just take light up the stage. This is the best card in my opponent's hand. And then, yeah, no attacks, I guess. It would be too bad if my opponent burned one of my creatures and then actually got a hit with the Kiln Fiend. So presumably my opponent is just deciding whether to play the Swift Spear before or after the crash through. That's a good turn. I feel like I have to just trade with the Kiln Fiend. Alternatively, I could just block and bounce off the Swift Spear. So, either way, I'm taking 7 damage. No, either 6 or 7 damage. The question is, do I just want to trade Kiln Fiend for Tarmogoyf? And that's an interesting question. There's also gut shot to consider, which would make blocking the Swiss Sphere very bad. I'm kind of just in huge trouble if my opponent has gut shot, because that's going to be 4, 5, plus 7 damage, 12. Maybe okay. Anyway, I think the slightly safer play is to block Kiln Fiend, though this is pretty close. I mean, an enormous Tarmogoyf is very good in this matchup, so I don't want to throw it away. But I have a powerful hand, and I just want to make sure nothing goes too badly wrong. Like, you can imagine... I don't know. I just think this is a little safer. So, Edict or Bloodbraid... I think I like Bloodbraid. This is the type of spot where there's really nothing bad that I can cascade into. Like, probably Thoughtseize would be the worst. Fatal Push, totally fine. And then I will make the Judgment Call to attack, even though my opponent does have a number of haste creatures. Two of the Swift Spears already in the graveyard, so there's no specific reason to think I'm getting attacked with haste next turn. Alright, I do not like going down to 6, but I think it's better than just basically doing nothing. I think I speed up my clock enough that it's worth it. Terrible cascade. And, it looks like my opponent's going to get 4 or 5 draw steps to piece together 2 3 damage removal spells. But actually not cracking the Fiery Islet. Now it makes sense. Card's very good against me. Now I can't even Liliana it. Suppose Inquisition plus Liliana is what the doctor calls for here. I'm probably going to lose this game because of these Fiery Islets allowing my opponent to refill the tank after they're on empty. Yep. So if my opponent has nothing or just one creature, I have lethal next turn by edicting and firing up the ravine. But of course at 2 life, I'm dead to huge number of draw steps my opponent could possibly have. Another Bedlam Reveler probably beats me. Well, I think I have to try it. Almost anything my opponent could have that would answer one of my creatures would have also killed me. So the only card that's a major concern here is Gutshot, which now kills me if I tap the Nurturing Peatland. But it has to be way better than giving my opponent an additional draw step. So that's my judgment call, and if they have Gutshot, I'll live with the decision. Wow, that was as close as it gets. All right, so Collective Brutality is my main sideboard card for this matchup. Nile Spellbomb used to be very effective against the Arclight Phoenix version, but it looks like this deck probably has just Bedlam Reveler and, you know, maybe some Lava Darts or something like that. We'll see what I have to take out. I think clearly Thoughtseize comes out. Dark Confidant is very bad. And then my next weakest card is, I guess, Renin 6. So maybe I just want two spell bombs, maybe third spell bomb over Renin 6. Opponent doesn't really have one toughness creatures, so yeah, this looks fine. I'm going to keep on the strength of my two removal spells. Unlike the traditional burn deck, this red prowess deck pretty much needs to deal damage with creatures in order to win. No blocks. Would you like to Gutshot or Mutagenic Growth? No, then I'll kill your Soulscar Mage. Sure. Grab Basic Forest, you do want to think about Blood Moon. Now the question is, how much do I want to think about Blood Moon? So much that I'm playing Bloodstained Mire or playing a tapped land. I think I should play the tapped land because it could get real ugly if I have to shock myself at a later time. I think it also would have been reasonable to Kolaghan's Command to take out the Swift Spear, but the Tarmogoyf's big enough against a mono red deck that I think it's just a great threat. Great threat, great blocker, everything. Make the judgment call to start attacking. You definitely don't want to trade damage in this matchup, but you also don't want to miss damage because giving them fewer draw steps can be quite important. Now I might get my ooze bolted, but I'm still going to make the judgment call to do this. Looks like my opponent just drew way too many lands. Maybe he has a Bedlam Reveler. So now I just need to think about what happens if my opponent plays Sixth Mountain and Bedlam Reveler. Is that a problem for me? And if it is a problem, then maybe I consider eating one of these right away. I think it's probably it's a tiny bit of a problem for me. So I guess I may as well do it. Eat the instant. Seems like my opponent just drew way too many lands in both games. So that Forked Bolt on Tarmogoyf. Sure. With the Soulscar Mage in play, so definitely relevant. Alright, so let's think about Lava Dart here. If I get Lava Darted, I go to 13 and I take 8. If I get Lava Darted twice, then I die. So I could think about a Chump Block here. The good thing about that is it does put another creature in the graveyard for scavenging use, and for Tarmogoyf for that matter. I think I'm fine with a block here. Embarrassment of riches here. Well, I think I'm just going to start by attacking and make my opponent do something. All right, on to 3-1. All right, here we are for round number 5. Currently 3-1. And on the draw, but with an excellent hand. Got discard or removal on turn 1, depending on what the matchup calls for, and then probably my two best 2 drops to choose from, so very pleased with this opener. Alright. So, pretty interesting situation. Generally, I like to abide by the philosophy of Bolt the Bird, but I do have Renin 6. So maybe I can get a little greedy here and Inquisition first and then try to use my 2-drop to kill it. If I bolt, then it's kind of going to be a tough decision on turn 2 of like, do I play another removal spell? Do I play a discard spell? If I don't play the discard spell, when am I going to get to play the discard spell? So I'm going to get a little greedy here and try to Inquisition, maybe take away my opponent's turn 2 play, and then Renin 6 can come down and kill the Hierarch. Looks like it will work out for me. Provided my opponent does not draw, you know, something like a 3-mana play or a counterspell. But come on, just attack me for 1, play a tapped Breeding Pool. That's what we need here. Pretty cool, I have not played against a Bant Stoneforge deck just yet. Oh no, don't play an untapped land. That cannot signal anything good. Oh my God, Vendilion click. All right. So what am I supposed to do? Am I supposed to play scared here? Like if I Ren in six and ping this, my opponent flashes in Vendilion click, then kills my planeswalker. I could just pass and try to bolt this in the upkeep. Or Abrupt Decay, whichever you prefer. I think I'm going to play scared. I'm going to respect my opponent's representation here. Abrupt Decay is also uncounterable for what that's worth. All right, Spell Queller. I guess that was a better prediction than Vendilion Click. Well, it'd be amazing for me if I draw a third land. I don't draw a third land. I know my opponent has Restoration Angel, Cryptic Command. Don't know about the unknown card. There's a draw step coming. It seems to me like I should just take this shot to bolt the Queller and Abrupt Decay the Hierarch, and then maybe my opponent will brick off or have a hard time hitting that fourth land. Okay, so that represents white mana for the Angel, but not blue mana for the Cryptic. Still struggling to hit the land drop. I guess I just thought seize here. Boy. Well, my original plan was to take the Cryptic, but I really don't want to leave my opponent with the combination of Quaddle Restoration Angel. I think I'm going to take... I'm going to take the Quaddle. Opponent electing not to flash in the Angel. They definitely are trying to operate on this this instant speed game plan. Protect themselves from my Planeswalkers. I definitely respect it. So I probably want to go Inquisition into Dark Confidant here, even though Inquisition can't take either of these two cards. And against blue-white control, I try to never fetch basics, but I could easily see my life total becoming relevant in this game with the Dark Confidant and Restoration Angel threatening to come in. Well, that's a pretty brutal hand. At least my opponent does not currently have an answer to the Confidant. If they do Teferi Tuck, I can finish off the one damage with Ren in six. Yep. Man, Man, really struggling with the land drops here. So I could play Ren in 6. Tick up, get the Verdant, play Scavenging Ooze. Then my opponent can kill the Ren and pass with Cryptic Mana open. But they can't really kill the Ren and play Teferi. Alternatively, I could play Lily and plus, but then my opponent... Yeah, I mean, that's not really happening. Attack and then Edict with Liliana. Lee just leaves me dead to Teferi, so I think I have to... basically, I have to complicate the board, because if my opponent just gets to have Teferi as the last permanent standing, I'm not winning. Okay, so Teferi and Cryptic in hand. My opponent may choose to kill the Ren and pass with Cryptic open. They may choose to ignore the Ren, play Teferi and plus. Then I get to kill the Quaddle. Yeah, I'm not... I would say I'm behind, but it's... There's no clear route for my opponent from here. Of course, if they play Teferi and plus and draw some kind of relevant instant speed card, then the whole house of cards falls down. But I have a shot, at least, if the top of their library doesn't deliver. Realistically, I think it's pretty bad for me if my opponent just kills my Planeswalker and passes with Cryptic. Yes, I have the Dark Confidant, but it's hard for me to really get any traction on the board. And again, the Teferi is just the game winner if it ever sticks. Yep, looks like my opponent's probably coming to the same conclusion. Well, Bloodbraid gives me a shot against the Teferi. I think I'm supposed to attack for 4 and then play Lily. And then because I've drawn the land, at least my opponent can't go counter bounce. They can go counter draw. So my opponent's going to have the Cryptic draw, their draw step, the Horizon Canopy, and the Teferi plus. 4 shots to find something powerful to do at instant speed. So I'm probably going to need my opponent to get a little unlucky, and I'm going to need a good Cascade with the Bloodbraid. I guess I do get the Dark Confidant still in play, so you never know if I could just find Lightning Bolt or something along those lines. Yes. Yes. Sadly, I don't think an extra power on the ooze is going to really matter here. So I'm not going to shock myself. Bolt. All right, I need a good cascade, and I need my opponent to not have a relevant instant. Okay, that's a good cascade. Certainly qualifies. So we are going discard and two to your snake. And then we're sending everything into Teferi. Opponent might just let the Planeswalker die and attacking back for four. I can gain two with my ooze. Some more in my upkeep. Alright. Well, I handled one of the emergencies, one of the pressing emergencies. Now I have to worry about my life total. Thankfully, a Bant deck like this is not going to have much reach. Could draw. I guess finding a sword off the top would be lethal. More exalted creatures. But what I can do is, if I can survive the attack by gaining life with Scavenging Ooze, then I can also gain more life in my upkeep to avoid dying to Dark Confidant trigger. What a game. Just trying to thread the needle here. All right. Okay, yeah, that's lethal. I guess my opponent was just thinking out carefully. But yep, that's going to be 5 plus 1 from the Exalted. I can only gain 2. Definitely want the engineers. Fulminator is okay in a matchup like this. Tend to have one grudge against Stoneforge decks. Collective Brutality kills a good amount. So what do I not want is an important question. This type of matchup's tricky because everything that's good against creature decks is good, but then everything that's good against control decks is also good. I tend to think Tarmogoyf is one of my weaker cards in a matchup like this. Like, these six creatures, it's not really the game plan I want. I more want to win with value and with Planeswalkers. Lily, I think, is just good. You know, they're all the flash creatures, but especially on the play, I just want to curve Disruption into Liliana. Not sure if the grudge is too ambitious. Maybe something like this. I do kind of want, like, one grudge. if I draw the grudge at any point, it basically invalidates the whole Stoneforge Mystic package. Which, granted, I have a lot of other answers to that, but I think that insurance is worth a slot for. Yeah, I mean, this hand's virtually perfect if I can just find another land. Three lands, Stoneforge, Pride Mage, Teferi. Guess I'm inclined to take Teferi. It's definitely not Pride Mage. In fact, I'm pretty surprised to see that in the deck post-sideboard against me. Yeah. All right, I like that draw. Now, whatever my opponent does, I think I'm not going to Abrupt Decay. I'm just going to Liliana and Edict, because the Liliana -2, when you can get it off in a nice, clean way where you're likely to untap with your Planeswalker, that's card advantage. When you plus, it's a symmetric effect, so I like to play the Lily and get the nice, clean value right away. And, yeah. Especially since it's not the Stoneforge, it is just pure card advantage. Just thinking about what land I might want to fetch. Opponent is playing a Path to Exile deck, so when in doubt, I'm going to leave the basics in my library. So this situation could be a little bit tricky because if I blood braid and brick, as in don't find a removal or a discard, then my opponent can basically get in a hit with the Sword of Feast and Famine. I guess they need a lot to go right. They need a land and me to brick on the cascade. So, but anyway, it's tricky. All right, drawing the grudge gives me a bit more flexibility. This is still very tricky, though. I think I'm going to plus, discard the grudge, see what my opponent discards. And if the sword is still in hand, then I don't really want to tap out for the Bloodbraid. So yeah, I'll just pass, probably Abrupt Decay, whatever my opponent attacks with, and then I have the grudge if they put the sword into play. Might get Restoration Angeled here. It's not the end of the world if it happens. I don't know why I tapped myself out of green. I don't think my opponent's that likely to just cast the Sword of Feast and Famine if they noticed the grudge, but still was not technically correct to tap out of green. Cash in the Lily. Play another. Just clean house. Hopefully there's not another Quaddle. And there's not. So, seem to have stabilized pretty nicely. Got the grudge in the graveyard for insurance. The Planeswalker is not threatened. Bloodbraid Elf for power. Sure. Against my better judgment, I think I'm going to discard Maelstrom Pulse. This stops my, the Teferi stops my cascade, right? So maybe this was, maybe I was just supposed to Maelstrom Pulse the Teferi and discard the Bob. I don't know. Yeah. I guess it's fine. Just blood braid against nothing. Bloodbraid and Liliana against nothing. My opponent seems to have quite the greedy mana base for a cryptic command, a three-color cryptic command deck. It almost looks like a Knight of the Reliquary mana base, but it also doesn't seem like they have Knight of the Reliquary. Okay, so I do kind of like my plan of boarding out all the 2-drop creatures. They're pretty vulnerable to Teferi. I wonder if I can punish my opponent with the Fulminators, keeping them off Teferi and Cryptic Command, which are the sort of the most powerful cards. So the way I look at it, I have 62 cards that I'm interested in. I would say I definitely don't want to cut anything that costs one mana. I think these are the cuttables. I do not want to cut Bloodbraid Elf, even in the face of Teferi. What's going on here? Sideboard bug? Okay. Liliana is definitely worse on the draw, vulnerable to the flash creatures, so I could see having maybe only three. I did like the Grudge. Yeah, let's try this. The Brutality is like, I think my opponent has few enough instants and sorceries that I'm never really going to just blind try to hit an instant or sorcery. So in some ways it's just an inefficient removal spell. But that's still okay. I want to try to kill every creature my opponent plays. And then there might be some times where I Inquisition and like see a Cryptic Command and then I can know to go for it with Brutality. I think it's an okay card, but not one of my stronger ones. All right, it's going to be a close match. I like my start. Thoughtseize Dark Confidant against a deck that's primary removal is going to be Path to Exile. I can still definitely lose to a nice Noble Hierarch draw. Or like a turn 3 Teferi to bounce the Confidant. But hopefully Thoughtseize can help me out here. Alright. Looks like both players with good starts. Okay, reminds me of the situation in game 1 where it's, I'm just crossing my fingers. Please don't find anything nice to play with your Hierarch. Seriously, no attack? Okay, I guess that can just represent Force of Negation for a possible Renin 6. But I'm just going to go for Dark Confidant here and Spell Queller would be absolutely brutal. Hopefully that doesn't happen. Path to Exile I can stand, but Spell Queller or Teferi would be pretty rough. Land. Very good. Okay, so I think we're definitely starting with Inquisition. Sure, I'll just push my advantage by taking the Coatl and thought seizing the Force of Negation. I can even attack for two. Nothing nasty. No Teferi. Okay, that's beatable. Interesting. I think my opponent has just drawn a few too many lands here, and my draw has been pretty strong. They really needed to tempo me with like a key draw step early in the game. But given that their draw has been bad enough that I actually get to play out all my cards, I think I'm going to have this one. No blocks. Sure. So might as well fetch a Blood Crypt also. I'm gonna go with Snake on the Plague Engineer. I'll just bolt the Hierarch, hit for 5. Then my opponent's gonna need something very special to get back in this. Snake, of course, is for the Ice Fang Quaddle. Alright, so I advanced to 4-1. I'll see you for round number 6. Alright, welcome back to round number 6 of the Modern Challenge. I'm now 4-1 after an 0-1 start, so starting to feel like I might be a relevant force in this tournament. It's going to be 8 rounds, probably needing 7-1 to make the top 8. This hand, I think, might be too bad if I was on the draw, but on the play, I can keep it. And hope to ride the Strength of Dark Confidant or Renin 6, picking off 1 toughness creatures to get me through the early and mid game. Rushland. So this could be a white-green Eldrazi deck, and perfect, red and six might get to do their thing. So this is basically the dream situation for Jund. My opponent mulliganed. I get to pick off their first creature for free. Now Liliana can come down, take out something bigger that's able to survive red and six is minus. So this is just about the perfect start. I'm just going to go ahead and get the Liliana out there. No fear of Obstinate Baeloth or anything like that in the first game. And I did missequence this. I should have picked up a land with Renin 6 and then discarded the same land. Instead, I'm going to discard the third land, and now my opponent will have slightly more information about the contents of my hand, so not a big deal, not something I'm going to lose any sleep over, but these little sequencing subtleties, it's good to hold yourself to a high standard with those. Sure, Thought Not Seer, not super effective. It will get to take away probably my Bloodbraid Elf, but then I get to Edict with Liliana. So having drawn that basic forest, I'm now going to start becoming more vulnerable to Path to Exile and Ghost Quarter, but at this point my lead is enough that I don't really care about my opponent disrupting my mana. Okay, I'm going to start here by plussing the Liliana. And I'm going to make a play that looks relatively strange, but I have the luxury to make it because I'm so far ahead in the game, which is that I'm going to deal one damage with my Ren and Six, then play a new Ren and Six and deal another one damage. So kind of weird to just throw away a Planeswalker that could have five loyalty. But again, my position is so strong. I don't need a Planeswalker in play to win. What I need is the game to not spiral out of control. Also has the nice side effect of pumping up Tarmogoyf 2, 3, 4. Yeah, that's not the winning play. Okay, let's start here. Path to Exile, Karn, Reality Smasher. Alright, my opponent has seen enough. Let's go to sideboarding. Another tricky sideboarding situation. Again, I like the one grudge. This is sort of my baseline against any deck with Stoneforge Mystic. Plague Engineer is going to be effective to name either Eldrazi or Human for Noble Hierarch. And then Fulminator is sort of the mystery card. I don't know if I want to be destroying Eldrazi temples or more trying to defend myself and protect against the initial rush of creatures. Another matchup where there's not really anything that's bad. Like, even Thoughtseize seems totally fine to take a Smasher or Thought-Knot-Seer. I don't want to overdo it with Discard because my opponent can empty their hand pretty quickly. Maybe I'll take out two Inquisitions. And then... I don't want to take out any of this top end. Maybe just, like... Confidant and a Goyf. The Goyf matches up okay against the Eldrazi. Maybe the fourth Liliana. You know, it is possible for my opponent to have a card like Rest in Peace, so maybe cutting some number of the Oozes or Tarmogoyfs makes sense. I guess I had miscounted. I only needed one cut there. Yeah, this looks fine to me. Excellent hand. All right. So three lands, no Eldrazi Temple. Displacer, Mindstone, Smasher. I think I should just plan for the long run, take the Smasher. This can definitely get bad for me if my opponent has a good draw step right now, but hopefully I can use Liliana to kill the Displacer the turn it comes down. Interesting to me that my opponent chose to use Horizon Canopy rather than Prismatic Vista. All right, and I can even put my Ancient Grudge to use, which I think is a better play than playing Tarmogoyf. Just trade off resources, make the Liliana very effective. Alright, I'll begin by plussing the Lily. I actually feel like I could discard Ren and Six. But no, I'll just discard Tarmogoyf. And with the Plague Engineer, I guess I'll just name Eldrazi. And I'm going to pass because I don't want my opponent to flicker one creature and then kill Liliana. Life total is not the important metric right now. Okay, well, it looks like they will be able to kill the Liliana after all. Perfect. Wow. That was a big turn. Okay. Well, I'm going to start by attacking. If my opponent blocks, I can just finish it off with Ren and Six. So there's no block there. Play my land plus the Lily. Now, I could ping the opponent. Just trying to think what gets them back into this. Yeah, it seems good to me. Because if they can somehow produce blockers against my creatures, then I might just be able to win over the course of three turns with Ren. This also means Kolaghan's Command at any point is lethal. Okay, that's actually one of the cards that allows my opponent to keep playing here. I guess I'm going to take my shot, Edict with Liliana. And if it's not a Path to Exile or a creature, then I just go for the attack. It's a Prismatic Vista. So hypothetically, my opponent could get one more draw off the canopy. But yeah, that's going to be it. That's the type of matchup that I really like to play with Jund. Where your removal is effective and you can sort of just dismantle them. And then my draws were very good. So smooth sailing. I'll see you for the next round. Welcome back, everybody. We're getting to the home stretch here, round 7 out of 8. I get to be on the play, but it looks like I'm going to have to take a mulligan here. And this one could work out. Thoughtseize into Tarmogoyf and maybe Liliana. I think I should probably bottom the Lightning Bolt, since it's I don't have red mana, and it's the less powerful of my two red cards. So just a refresher, my record right now is 5-1. This tournament is going to be 8 rounds of Swiss with a cut to top 8. But since I lost that very first round, my tiebreakers are not good. So I'm only going to be in the top 8 if I can achieve the full 7-1 record winning the last 2 matches. So I'll be trying. Still a lot of work to do though. It's likely to be a painful start for me. Nurturing Peatland is one of my only two lands. Turn one Thoughtseize. I could easily be at like 13 or 14 life by the time the dust settles in the early turns here. So hopefully my opponent's not playing Burn or a very aggressive deck. And if they are, I'll have to draw red mana for that Lightning Bolt post-haste. My opponent, either with a very tough mulligan decision or has not arrived yet, looks like they're going to keep 7. I'll keep the 6, throw back the Lightning Bolt, and start things off with Thoughtseize. Ooh, one of my most dreaded matchups. Red-green Valakut. So, don't have to worry about that Lightning Bolt. I can either take the Titan directly, or I can take one of the Mana Ramp cards. Gotta worry about that Acid Moss when my hand is Mana Light. So, yeah, I mean, I think that's what I should take, right? Because it's tempting to take the Titan as the most powerful card, but if I leave my opponent with Tribelder into Acid Moss, that means I'm going to get Stone Rained before I hit my fourth mana. No hope of casting the Bloodbraid Elf, and could be in trouble in terms of even casting Liliana. So The plan is going to be take Acid Moss and hopefully work on my opponent's hand with Deliliana, maybe get the Titan out of there somehow. But this, make no mistake, this is a very bad matchup for me, and my opponent has an excellent, excellent hand. The traditional knowledge is that Jund's arch nemesis is Urzatron, and certainly that's a matchup that I've played and lost many, many times over the years, but I actually am much more afraid of Valakut than Urzatron because of their ability to just put a lot of mana into play and then top deck any of their super powerful cards, whereas Tron, if you can at least stop them from putting together Tron, you know, that's a route to victory, but it's pretty hard to stop the Valakut deck from getting six lands. All right, I hit my land for Liliana, so there is some hope. And I think I want to keep the other Liliana since I'm going to need to get cards out of my opponent's hand to stop the Titan. There's even not even any guarantee that I'm going to find another source of mana to cast the Bloodbraid anyway, so discard that. All right, I mean, I don't even know if my opponent has another card that can be hit by Inquisition of Kozilek, so I'm going to stick with the plan of Liliana plus, leave my opponent with one card, presumably just the Primeval Titan, and then maybe Liliana can actually prevent them from getting enough resources. My strategy in this matchup is very much just about attacking their raw quantity of resources. That's why you saw me be okay with the exchange of Tarmogoyf for Lightning Bolt. A lot of matchups I would try to avoid that. But with this, any one-for-one trade is okay by me because I just have to keep them from getting to that six-mana mark. All right, so my opponent has one unknown card in hand. So now if I edict with the Liliana, my opponent can either sacrifice both Tribe Elders in response or just do nothing. So I think that's worth it for me. This will put them up to effectively four mountains, so not much worry of triggering Valakut to kill the Dark Confidant or the Liliana, not just yet at least. But yeah, make no mistake, I'm still very far behind in this game because at any point, if my opponent draws Primeval Titan or one mana away from Scapeshift being lethal, that's it. And almost any card in their deck gets them closer to triggering those Valakuts. So it's going to take a lot of luck for me to be able to close the game before my opponent finds a way out. Tarmogoyf is a great start, though, as that actually represents a very real clock. Okay, so that's the fifth mountain. All right, let's go with the Nurturing Peat land here. That's actually very strong because I can use the Kolaghan's Command during my opponent's draw step to reduce their their live draws. This Valakut deck does operate mostly at sorcery speed. Ooh, painful. Yep. And let's see if my opponent decides to go at me with the 6 damage, maybe kill the Tarmogoyf, maybe kill... All right, I guess they can decide at instant speed with the Wooded Foothills. But meanwhile, we're going to go for a tapped Blood Crypt, and please find me a land, Dark Confidant. Ugh. Not what I wanted to see. So now I'm dead to almost any card in my opponent's deck. Anything that can produce a mountain. So it's easier to count the number of cards that don't kill me, which would be like Valakut, Basic Forest, Lightning Bolt. Lightning Bolt very likely kills me anyway because of the Dark Confidant. Man, if I had drawn a third land too, the Kolaghan's Command would effectively shut off the Wooded Foothills, but the combination of the Acid Moss and me not finding another source of mana is particularly devastating. But I guess situation's pretty clear-cut here. I just have to put Tarmogoyf into play and see if I'm dead. And that'll do it. My opponent cracks the first foothills to get the fifth mountain. The first foothills for the sixth mountain. Next foothills for the seventh, and that's going to be 12 damage to me. Close game. I think it all came down to whether or not I was going to be able to cast that Kolaghan's Command, but a strange turn of events led to me being unable to do so. And unlike most matchups with Jund, this can arguably get even worse after sideboarding when my opponent gets access to Obstinate Baloth. The only clearly good cards I have are Alpine Moon and Fulminator Mage. Actually, Plague Engineer is decent to name Snake because that will stop Sakura Tribelder from being able to do anything. But yeah, Obstinate Baloth is probably the single most impactful sideboard card that either player has access to. I think this is roughly where I want to be. Well, it's a good hand. I mean, I have a turn 2 threat, I have the Alpine Moon. Search for Blood Crypt. All right, come on, third land. Got there. And yeah, Plague Engineer is probably the right call here. It's going to work out well if my opponent has extra copies of Tribelder in hand. Can't imagine it matters whether I name Snake or Shaman. Go with Snake. All right, attack for four and Fulminator. I guess the Valakut. Maybe Stomping Ground. Sure, I'll blow up the Stomping Ground. Maybe I can prevent my opponent from casting two green spells in the same turn. Yeah, trigger off the Valakut, so maybe I should have just destroyed Valakut. Definitely have to play Alpine Moon this turn. So my inclination is Plague Engineer and Tarmogoyf, or excuse me, attack with Plague Engineer, Tarmogoyf, Alpine Moon, just to maximize the chances of clocking for next turn. I could also try to make my opponent discard in case they happen to have, you know, Nature's Claim and Scape Shift, and maybe they would choose to discard one. But I think I just want to get this game over with. So attacking, playing Tarmogoyf, playing Alpine Moon. And yeah, I wonder about that land destruction choice last turn. I mean, my opponent had a green-red dual land and double search, which is, it's not super easy to predict that. But, I mean, maybe I should just go with the obvious play of destroying Valakut. I don't know. Alright, so Titan comes down. Can it find anything with the Valakut shut off? Field of the Dead, wow! That's pretty sweet. Alright, I guess I am soundly defeated by this Field of the Dead tech. What can I do? I can try to burn my opponent out. I can play Bloodbraid Elf and hope I get lucky. I guess that's what I have to do. All right, same play again. Tarmogoyfs are doing a good job holding the fort. As soon as I say that, wow. My opponent makes this play, I may just take the damage and try to win on the attack back. Okay, so this would be an attack for 16, which means I need to block with two creatures. So something like this would have me taking uh, 12 damage. And then, I mean, I'm always drawing to Maelstrom Pulse, maybe. That's going to make it hard. Combination of the Relic and the Obstinate Bailoff is going to make it very hard for me to win. Probably just need Maelstrom Pulse to stay in the game. I'm not really seeing anything. I have three blockers. Kolaghan's Command Liliana can take out two attackers. The Windswept Heath can always make another creature end of turn. So I think this one is over. There's no way I can draw an extra card. Ooh, what if I Kolaghan's Command and return the Plague Engineer? But to cast it, I'd have to go out onto one, so the zombies are all still lethal anyway. Returning Fulminator Mage, Dark Confidant, Bloodbraid, they all don't do anything. Yep, so that's going to be it. Tough matchup, and nice work by my opponent with the Field of the Dead technology, and just generally really, really strong draws both games. One Vuli Acid Moss coming in big. So yeah, that's going to drop me to 5-2. No top 8 this time, but we'll still be doing our best to win the last round. I'll see you there. Hello everybody, welcome to the 8th and final round of today's Modern Challenge. I'm 5-2, so no top 8, but we're trying our best to go out on a good note. And my opponent is none other than the esteemed Paul Rietzel. This is going to be a fun and interesting final match. I have no idea what my teammate is playing, but I have a pretty decent draw on the play, so let's get to it. Paul played Jund at the last Mythic Championship, but he's also known for his love of Mox Opal decks like Hardened Scales or Affinity. Generally a player with quite a wide range of decks that he's able to pilot. Forest Relic. So could be Hardened Scales, but feels most likely to be Valakut. And I guess he's going to neutralize my Renin 6, and I'll just have to play Dark Confidant. My Renin 6 and my Tarmogoyf, for that matter. Oh, wow. It's Urzatron. You don't necessarily see Forest Relic. I don't know if I've ever seen an Urzatron player not play a Tron piece before turn three. This is somewhat absurd. So hopefully I can steal game number one in this very, very bad matchup, and then we'll see where the rest of the match takes us. I will say that the relics are among the best cards against Jund. And I'm lucky in this game that I have Dark Confidant, because otherwise taking the wind out of the sails of both Renin 6 and Tarmogoyf would just dramatically reduce my clock. Well, I suppose I'm just going to try to pound with Bloodbraid Elf. Good Cascade. Go ahead and activate this first. So you can see that on the board, I should be able to put Paul to one next turn with the Bloodbraid from my hand. Alright, so there seem to be two approaches that I can take here. Either I can try to unload maximum damage, or I can attack Paul's hand with Thoughtseize and Inquisition and Liliana Plus. Both seem very appealing, and I think I prefer to do the attack the hand strategy. So let's begin with Thoughtseize. Paul has decided to concede. So on to game two. I get my Fulminators, my Alpine Moon, my Collector Oofs, I suppose Ancient Grudge as well, my big sideboard cards. Out comes most of my removal. Scavenging Ooze is pretty weak. And then Abrupt Decay is sort of the flex slot. I definitely like Abrupt Decay when I'm on the play, because sometimes you can just tag that turn one Expedition map. On the draw, though, I think it's about equal to a Lightning Bolt, and I'll go ahead and have this just, as a cheaper card, kill a Worm token, kill a Karn that minuses, deal that last 3 points of damage sometimes. But yeah, this is a pretty strong configuration against Urzatron. This is going to be the tougher of the two games when I'm on the draw, but hopefully I can steal one of them and finish the tournament 6-2. This is the type of hand that I might keep in game number one, but after sideboarding when I have Fulminator Mage and Alpine Moon in addition to my discard spells, that would be really, really strong draws. I think I can do better than this. Rather, I think I have to do better than this. And this is at least a tiny bit better based on the strength of Collector Oof. So I think I'm going to keep this and bottom, I guess, one of the Kolaghan's commands. All right, so that's going to be turn three Tron. This is a little bit more of like how the game is quote unquote supposed to go in the matchup. And we very quickly got to a point where Collector Oof is going to be ineffective. Later on, it can still stop, I guess, a Oblivion Stone, but for now, I should probably just play Ren and Six. Yep, this one's not going to be easy. Paul should probably go upstairs. He is going to do so. And now I'm pretty much on Maelstrom Pulse or bust. All right. Karn the Great Creator. So I suppose the only way I can really continue playing is if I Thought Seize and then Kolaghan's Command to deal two to the Karn and either destroy the bridge or make my opponent discard. Then you won't be able to fetch the Mycosynth Lattice. Alright, so goodbye Oblivion Stone. I should have played the peatland and kept the forest because he's He might exile a card from my hand. So a lot just happened there. Paul has one Urza's Tower left in hand. Need a big cascade. Maelstrom Pulse. So I have to imagine Paul blocks here, then he can fetch Walking Ballista. I mean, unless he put them all in his deck, but he can fetch Walking Ballista, which would basically kill me. So I think I should destroy either the mine or the power plant right now. That's going to be finally enough for me to concede this game. And going to game three, I'm going to make that swap that I talked about. Lightning Bolt for Abrupt Decay, sometimes tag the Expedition map. So we're tied 1-1. I'd actually say that this match is going better than expected because normally, you lose game one, win game two, and then you have to be on the draw for the rubber match. But this time, I actually get to be on the play, where Collector Oof, Fulminator Mage, and Liliana of the Veil are a lot more effective. I actually believe that I'm not a favorite to win the match, but I do think I'm probably a favorite in the single sideboard game where I get to be on the play. Though it is still very close, and you need a good hand. Alright, I mean, this doesn't have any of my sideboard cards, but this is what I would describe as a good normal hand. You know, Thoughtseize into Goyf and maybe Liliana. So I'm definitely going to keep this. Okay, so we have a non-Tron hand from Paul. He has only one Tron piece, Thragtusk, a couple of cantrips. So I'm not going to take the Worldbreaker. And I think I'm just going to take the Chromatic Star, probably. And try to keep him off of Tron as long as I can. There's some consideration to taking Thragtusk, but I'm hoping that I can either pressure his resources or just get the game close to finished before that point. Taking the star is better because if I draw Ancient Grudge, I can kill the Chromatic Sphere. So I do think I should Thoughtseize here, and then I can take the Thragtusk and be informed as to whether or not I need to use Inquisition. The reason I'm doing it is I feel like this is sort of like my last chance to use these cards to good effect. And I would rather be on the Liliana resource denial plan than the Tarmogoyf beatdown plan. Okay, so he did not find anything that I can Inquisition away. So now I just have to decide whether to take the Thragtusk or the Wormcoil Engine. I think I should take the Wormcoil Engine. very big draw step here coming up. I feel that if I can play Liliana on turn three, he's going to be really under a lot of pressure in terms of his resources. But if I can't and I just have to play a 4-5 creature, then Tron really gets to do its thing. So that's funny. Both Paul's draw step and the Ancient and the Chromatic Sphere resulted in Ancient Stirrings. Okay, it was not a land, but it is a good card. This can basically deny the Worldbreaker from being a relevant force for a while. Might as well fire off the Inquisition. The only... Actually, is that true? I think it's not true that I should fire off the Inquisition, because almost any card that Paul could have drawn, he would have cast, and I can keep the Inquisition as fodder for Liliana. So instead, what I'm going to have to do is play Alpine Moon. Note that Paul does have Blast Zone to take care of it, but it will delay him for a full turn in addition to pumping out my Tarmogoyfs. So I'm just going to play Alpine Moon, naming Urza's Mine, and attack and play Raging Ravine. Actually, one thing that I perhaps should have considered would be Inquisitioning myself. I think it would be too extreme, but pumping up the Tarmogoyf by putting a Planeswalker into the graveyard is pretty decent. Okay, so Urza's Mine. I like to name the one that they do not have in play because it does allow the land to tap for any color, which is like a small bonus. So the key is turning off the actual Tron, but not giving Paul access to additional colored mana. So I'm guessing this turn will just be Blast Zone and use it at the end of the turn. One thing that's tricky is if I do play the second Tarmogoyf, he might then decide, okay, I'm just going to take up the Blast Zone and destroy your Goyfs for two. Alternatively, he may decide to just cast Thragtusk next turn. So this is a little bit of a tricky situation. I don't think Liliana really does enough. So the question is if I just want to force his hand on using the Blast Zone on the two Tarmogoyfs. And then, of course, an additional question is, do I want to now fire off the Inquisition? And I think the answer is yes. So he drew Ulamog, which means if he does ever wind up deciding to destroy my two Tarmogoyfs instead of my Alpine Moon, it really makes it hard for him to cast the Worldbreaker and the Ulamog. So a little bit of a tough spot for Paul to decide what to do. And if he just destroys Alpine Moon and plays Worldbreaker, he's not dead, but he's getting close. Because I can Liliana Edict away the Worldbreaker. So I put him to 2. He needs another Tron piece to play Ulamog. Otherwise, it's Thragtusk, which would have him still surviving. Kolaghan's Command, lethal. All right. Non-land card, come on. Oh, man, the crucial draw step. I imagine he's going to discard the Ulamog, keep the Thragtusk, which will put him out of burn range. But the game is still... I mean, this is still a little bit of a contest because... The Tarmogoyfs are pretty large. They even become 6/7s if the Liliana dies. I'm going to have to let that go. I can't afford to trade both Tarmogoyfs. And here comes Thragtusk and add a counter to Walking Ballista. Little help here. Bloodbreed, Kolaghan's Command. Okay, Kolaghan's Command. So what can I do with this? Can go destroy Wyrmcoil, 2 damage to Ballista. Do I send in the Tarmogoyfs first? I think the answer is yes. So if I attack with both Goyfs, Paul could decide to block a Thragtusk on a Goyf, block a Walking Ballista, and then shoot, which would be just a very good play, but it would cause him to lose both of his creatures just on the board. And then I can go destroy the Wyrmcoil, make you discard in your draw step, and then we have 3/3/3 creatures against a Tarmogoyf. Alternatively, I could just destroy this, deal 2 damage here, he shoots... Probably me for 2. Then I pass, and we have a little bit of a stalemate. I think I like the Tarmogoyf against 3/3/3s and denying his draw step better. Alternatively, I could just... Alternatively, I could just return a Tarmogoyf. Okay, so as planned, Paul's going to make that trade. Now, Kolaghan's Command, I think, is better to return the Goyf than to deny a random draw step, even though there are some pretty powerful draw steps in Tron. Destroy target artifact, return target creature. And the Goyf's now 7-8. Had we really been missing instant that whole time? Wow, so maybe I made a bad error. I guess it's roughly this. It's actually the same. I get an untapped Tarmogoyf this way. So I could have used the Kolaghan's command to make the Goyf a 7-8 in combat, but it's basically the same outcome, same board state. All right, so Paul's actually going to use the Worldbreaker ability to return it. And 7-8, if I attack, he goes double block one. I guess I'm just passing. No, it's deja vu from the Valakut match. The crucial moment where I really need my Goyfs to hold up. Relic is the draw, just the devastating draw. So now I'm in chump lock mode. And Paul's going to put me out of my misery anyway with the All is Dust because Worldbreaker is devoid. That's all she wrote. So a tough battle in the last match, but I am going to fall to 5-3. Nevertheless, it was a great day. I hope you enjoyed the video, and I'll be back soon again with more content on ChannelFireball.com. See you next time.